Hello and welcome to episode 49 of the Desmond's Flicks podcast. On this episode, I'm joined by Jonathan Milott and Cary Murnion. They've directed such films as Bushwick, Cooties, and most recently, Becky, starring Lulu Wilson, Kevin James, and Joel McHale. So sit back, relax, subscribe to the podcast, and enjoy the episode.
Can you take a moment to introduce yourselves and the work that you've done prior to Becky?
Sure. This is Cary Murnion.
And this is Jonathan Milott.
So we're here talking about Becky. It's our third feature film. The other two films we've directed are Cooties. It's a horror comedy starring Elijah Wood, Allison Pill, and Rainn Wilson. And then our second film was Bushwick, kind of an action war film starring Brittany Snow and Dave Bautista.
I love Cooties, and I love Elijah Wood.
Yeah, he loves genre films, and his company, Spectrevision, is one of the kind of leading independent, movie production studios that do these kind of really kind of interesting movies. They produced Mandy, which I'm sure your audience loves, and they did the new Color of Space that came out this past year. It was also Nicolas Cage, and this kind of really makes some really unique movies, and Elijah Wood is a big fan of promoting and kind of doing these movies that don't normally get out there like this.
And we are obviously huge fans of his going in. You know, I don't know anyone in the world who doesn't love Lord of the Rings. So between him and all those other great actors in Cooties, that was the first time we had ever really worked with stars of that caliber. So that was one of the highlights of our careers, was that first day on set when we were in a packed lunchroom, or like a teacher's lunchroom, which was the set in Cooties, and it was just filled with all these stars that, you know, Rain we had watched on The Office, Allison Pill we had seen in so many movies, and just everybody in that room was just awesome, and it was such an exciting way to kind of to start off our film career.
That's amazing to get all of those people together to be a part of that project. And you guys did it again with Becky, with Kevin James and Lulu Wilson. We'll get to them in a bit and the process of getting them on board. But I wanted to ask you guys, how did you guys end up making the film Becky, and where did the idea come from?
Yeah, the idea came from a script that we got from our managers and agents. And essentially we were...
And it was just written by Nick Morris.
Nick Morris. Name. Yeah. And so we love the original script. We like the idea. But we thought, you know, as most directors do, we thought we could really take that idea and kick it up a notch, which is essentially our job as directors. So we pitched that back to the producers, and they agreed that we could work with Ruckus and Lane, a married couple who are also writers, to kind of enhance some of the ideas that were there and really push it over the top. And that was our goal. Let's take this premise of a 13-year-old girl kicking ass and getting revenge and make sure it delivers on that premise.
And I gotta say, Lulu Wilson kicked so much ass. I even said during my review, I'd love to see her and Samara Weaving in a film together.
That'd be a good combo, yeah. And I think a big part of this film is the perspective, you know, showing the perspective of the whole movie from Becky's point of view. And, you know, we frame the movie with her point of view and kind of use that as our way to kind of to bring the audience in, and also have the audience question what's being told. You know, since one girl's telling the story, you know, what's real and what's not. And I think that's kind of an interesting aspect of this film.
How do you two decide how to share the workload on a project like this?
Yeah, we've been working together for a long time now, so it's our process has grown a bit organically, and basically we've gotten to the point where we've decided that the best approach is to let one of us lead on set, because we do a lot of prep, we do a lot of storyboarding, shot listing, working with the actors before the actual shoot day. We work together in all that prep, working with the art directors and the stunt coordinators. So really all that prep goes into that one day of shooting, but on that day of shooting we have one person lead. And then we both are wearing Comtex, which is a walkie-talkie in your ear. So one person can be on set leading and, you know, working with the actors really close and personal, working with the cinematographer, and the other person can be back at the monitors, like a really big monitor in Video Village, kind of overseeing everything and making sure that nothing slips through the cracks and everything's working great, and, you know, kind of backing up the person leading on set. And it just creates a great, more seamless way of communicating between the two of us and with everybody else. So there's no confusion on set. Nobody's going to one of us and asking one question and then getting a contradictory answer from another person. But yeah, it's really about prep and then that communication on set.
As I was watching the movie, the thing that really popped out to me was Kevin James. He kind of reminded me of what Vince Vaughn did in Brawl in Cell Block 99. Nice. And, you know, that was the kind of vibe I was getting. How did you guys get Kevin James to become a part of the project?
That's cool. You know, we really love the Brawl. That movie is just nuts, and we love that level of violence. is something that it's cinematic violence to us. You know, I think there's a big difference, and between real violence and cinematic violence, and that idea that you can kind of get out your aggressions and kind of sit back and let this, you know, shocking ride, you just ride it and have fun with it and not, you know, take it too seriously. But yeah, we were talking to Simon Pegg originally about that role, and a scheduling conflict came up, so he had to bail, and we had originally been talking to Simon about playing the father role.
Kevin.
So Kevin, yeah, sorry. Simon Pegg was going to be Dominic, and Kevin James was going to be the father of Becky. And that all shifted. So when Simon Pegg had to bail, Kevin James showed interest, and we started talking to him about the, you know, the tone and how we wanted to see that character. And we just really hit it off, and we really were just on the same page. So Kevin James kind of slid in, and then we had the opening for the father role, and that's how we got Joel McHale for the father role at the last second. Like, literally, we were on location a week or two out to film, and we got Joel.
You guys did great work with Kevin James. He was incredible in this film. I hated him throughout the film, which is a testament to how good he was.
The reason why he was attracted to this role was that it wasn't some kind of redemption for this character. It wasn't like he was a Nazi and always going to be turned good at the end or have even like a soft side. Like, he was fully evil. We did like, you know, about the character that he was kind of charming in the sense that like a cult leader would be, that he would kind of draw you in, and, you know, the things he says are very evil, but the way he says it can lull you into a false sense of, like, you know, is it actually logical or what he's saying? And I think that's what was unique about this character and why Kevin was drawn to it, was, you know, something that he could bring that affable kind of next door kind of neighbor type of feel to this, you know, horrible person, and then bring that into the family and kind of disrupt this whole family.
How did you guys decide to go with Lulu Wilson for the main role? And was there an audition process, or did you just know you wanted her from the beginning?
Yeah, we knew right from the beginning, and thank God she was, she loved the script and was pretty much always involved right from the start. But we've been following her career since she was much younger, and just always blown away by her work. And as we were developing the script, we kind of saw her growing, and we were like, okay, we got to make this happen before she gets too old. But I mean, she's blown us away in things like Sharp Objects and The Haunting of Hill House. Just really mature, like really dark and mature performances.
I'm a big practical effects guy, and it looks like you guys are too. What was the process of, you know, doing the practical effects and then also doing the stunt work?
Yeah, that was really important for us. For us, it's that thing of the more you can do on set with the actors interacting with each other, with the blood, with the gore, just the more intense and fun and visceral it can be. And I think it helps the actors too. There's definitely a lot of moments where Lulu herself, with Kevin, with Joel, they all really got in there and were able to do a lot of the stunt work themselves. We also had a great stunt coordinator and stunt team that, you know, could do the moments where they pick Becky's character up and just slam her, or where, you know, they're going down zip lines and getting clotheslined off the zip line and landing on their heads, things like that, that, you know, we actually got Lulu on the zip line. So there's actual footage of Lulu going down a zip line, which is, you know, it seems fun enough, but when you're in the middle of production, the last thing you want is your star to fall and hurt herself, or, you know, just even get a little injury. So we were lucky that we, you know, with a lot of safety harnesses and safety equipment, we got shots of her actually ziplining. But then, you know, we trade her out for this, you know, older stunt woman who was about the same height, that could do some of the falling off and the more intense stuff. But yeah, it was really cool. And then with the prosthetics too, just a lot of great prep work with the makeup visual effects team, and kind of like some ideas that we had, them bringing some ideas to us, and basically them really enhancing a lot of the ideas that we have, really adding elements of blood tubes and pumps, and giving us ideas like when Lulu's stabbing somebody and she's like on their back and she's just stabbing them repeatedly with a broken ruler, creating like buckets of blood that you don't see off camera, but you just see like when a stab comes up that there's blood squirting everywhere. So working with, you know, our idea is just have her stabbing and blood going everywhere. And then the makeup effects team, like, really working with us to make it so it can actually happen on camera. Because there's one thing thinking of that idea, and then there's another of actually executing it.
We touched a bit on Joel McHale earlier on. What was the process of getting him a part of the film as well?
Oh, my God. Like I said, that was crazy because we were literally, I mean, it might have been under a week. It was really close to shooting. We had to scramble to get him, and we were up in Canada, out in farm country, and there was literally no phone connection. We couldn't even make a typical call with him. So what we did was we found this restaurant and it had Wi-Fi. So we pulled our car up close enough in the back of the restaurant to tap into their Wi-Fi, put our phone on the dashboard of our car. It looked like we were driving while we were calling him, but we did a Skype FaceTime call with him. And the restaurant owner at one point in the middle of talking to Joel McHale was yelling at us, like, what are you guys doing? And we're like, oh, this is Hollywood, huh, I guess. But yeah, he had his Emmy behind him, kind of jokingly. And it was just a crazy call because we really hit it off. And, you know, he sounded on board to do whatever it took to do the movie. But he was in the middle of a tour, a comedy tour, which was taking him all over the United States. So he said he was in, but then we had to figure out the logistics of flying him in to shoot and then flying him out to get to the comedy. And he just was that committed that he could do that, you know, through exhaustion, through probably some sleepless nights and just a lot of back and forth. So we were really lucky to get him.
What was the process of getting this movie made? Can you walk us through a little bit of how you got funding, the process of getting all the pieces in place, and, you know, up until you actually began shooting?
Yeah, it was kind of roundabout because, you know, first it's the pitch, like we said, and then we do the rewrite, and then we go into trying to get financing. And there's always this juggling kind of back and forth between casting. When you're doing an indie film, is you've got to cast it with some actors who have some name recognition. You can't just go to the corner and find some really good actor that you know and make a movie. You have to. It's a very intricate business of numbers and foreign sales and what financiers are looking for and the script. But and then, you know, you have to find name actors that like the script, that like our vision for it. So it's this game of kind of like talking to actors, talking to financiers, you know, working really hard with our agency, UTA. They did a lot of work behind the scenes to get this movie made. But then, you know, hopefully, like in this case, some of the pieces just start falling into place. In this case, it was Simon Pegg was one of the first pieces of the puzzle. When he came on board, then we could kind of, you know, start building the financing around that. But then he fell out, so then we almost lost it. And then Kevin came in, and so then it was back on. But then it's once we get the financing and the casting in place, you find a location. And in this case, it was set in Atlanta or around Atlanta and Georgia, but we got a tax break in Canada. So we had to go up and do some location scouting in Canada and make sure that we could, you know, find a lake house and a lake and just the whole scene and still make it feel like that Georgia area that we wanted. So then, you know, from there, we do a lot of the pre-production process, which is, you know, building out the locations, the art direction, the costume design, designing the tattoos, designing and building out the special effects makeup, working with the stunt coordinator to do all the stunts, fine-tuning the script, making sure that we can execute the script in the amount of days that we have. And in this case, we had pretty much every aspect of filmmaking that they tell you not to do. We had kids, we had dogs, we had water stunts, we had, you know, the makeup, the prosthetics.
Fire.
So it's like all these things that add a lot of time to the actual filming day, driving. It's just a lot of things that require a lot of safety and making sure the kids are safe. So, you know, you just are limited in what you can shoot in a day. So all that goes into the pre-production and the pre-planning, and then 25 days of shooting, and then a few months of editing, and then the post-production process, which in our case was cut short by a pandemic. So we had to, we were on the first day of sound mix, which is pretty much one of the last steps in the process. And we had to shut it down and go home and finish the sound mix remotely, which should have taken about a week, but turned into about a month worth of work because of the back and forth that's required working remotely.
I know I'm kind of fanboying out, but I loved this movie so much.
Well, you won't hear any complaints from us. It's always good to hear. You know, it's definitely, it's like all of our films, it's very divisive. There's a lot of people that just don't like watching violence or things like that. So it's good to hear when people do connect with it, because we know we have a bit of a twisted sense of humor, a twisted sense of what's cool and what's fun and what we like to watch. And that's in a way why we make movies like this. You know, movies like Old Boy, the Korean movie Old Boy, is just so insane to us and so over the top. But that's the type of movie we like to see. So, you know, that's what we're trying to make. It's just something that will shock you, will kind of like make you, you know, kind of see something you've never seen before. So it's cool. It's cool that you connected in the same way we do.
What are some of your strongest influences in books or movies?
Yeah, it's, I think it, very easily with this one, more specifically, it's revenge movies. Like I said, Old Boy, Tarantino, you know, anything from Tarantino, we just love. We kind of reference Sicario. We think of that as a kind of fucked up, twisted revenge movie. So movies like that definitely played into this, you know, into our inspiration for this.
And another one in terms of tone is Green Room, that kind of has that feeling of, you know, people trapped, you know, regular people trapped and have to find their way to get out of something and do things that they didn't expect to have to do that day.
If you could work with anyone in the industry right now, who would it be and why?
Ooh, work with anyone. I mean, I know for sure we want to work with Dave Bautista again. We had such a great time working with him, and he brings a physicality and an emotional level, you know, at the same time, just like big beast of a man that is just, he's like a lion. But at the same time, he has this depth and this emotional ability to really convey so much without even saying a lot. So we loved working with him. We want to work with him again. You know, almost everyone that we've worked with, we would die to work with them again. But just a matter of finding the right projects.
I've always wanted to work with Charlize Theron. I think she's just, I mean, seeing her in both, you know, Mad Max and then what she did in Atomic Blonde, I feel like she brings something really unique to action films, and she's kind of up. She's like our generation's Sigourney Weaver, who redefines the female action hero.
Are there any upcoming projects you guys are able to talk about? And will you continue working together, or do you have separate plans for the near future?
Yeah, I guess we'll keep working together. Yeah, no, definitely we have plans to keep working together. And in terms of what we're working on next, we have a few projects in the works. Mostly what we can say about them is that if you like this kind of visceral, intense violence and action, I think we're just hoping to keep pushing the boundaries and push it into another level. You know, that's just kind of what we're trying to do with each film is take it up a notch.
Well, you guys made an amazing film with Becky. It's one of my favorites of the year. I love this film. It takes me back to, you know, those exploitation revenge films. You guys did great work, and the cast did an amazing job. And I want to thank you both for joining me today.
Oh, it was fun. Thanks so much for having us today. And it was a lot of good questions there. Thanks so much.
Where can folks find you on social media, and where can they go and check out Becky?
You can find us on Instagram, at Cary and John. And then the movie is playing in over 50 drive-in theaters across the country, with also two in Canada. And then you can find it on all digital and VOD platforms, you know, Amazon, you know, Prime to rent it and buy it, you know, iTunes, and then any kind of cable network, you can rent it there as well.
Thank you again to Cary and John for joining me on the show. Thank you all again for joining me on another episode of the Desmond's Flicks podcast. And I'll see you guys next time. Same spooky time, same spooky channel.